Hello learners, welcome to an IOS classroom. Today we are going to discuss course code 508, unit 7, School Health Education Program. The learning objectives of this course is that reading this lesson, you will be able to explain the importance of safe drinking water and safe food, state about proper lighting, ventilation and comfortable seating arrangement, create positive emotional and social environment in the class, explain the importance of food and balanced diet, recognize communicable diseases, describe good posture and healthy habits. Let's discuss a healthful school environment. The school is an important and basic unit of the society. As we know, a good school with healthful environment is the foundation on which the society is based. In the school environment, child learns to eat, play, share and care, make new friends also. He becomes familiar with eating habits, food, cleanliness, hygiene and so many other things. School authorities and teachers should take care of all these aspects. So, let's discuss the clean drinking water supply. The main sources of drinking waters are mainly wells, rivers, ponds, hand pumps, taps, etc. Nowadays, water is polluted by washing clothes and utensils, throwing waste, drainage of chemical and performing some rituals in the rivers. In urban cities, there are many methods to get clean water with the help of RO system and other purifying systems, etc. In schools, there should be a provision of safe drinking water, covered storage of water, be adequate drinking water according to the school strength. And in urban cities, municipal corporation plays major role in supplying clean drinking water to schools. We should be particular that in every school, the water storage tanks are cleaned regularly. The special records are kept for the cleaning. The water purifier and chlorine tablets are provided by the school authorities, and the teacher should give regular practice of not wasting water and reusing it for gardening, cleaning floors, etc. Let's discuss the importance of clean toilets and urinals. Schools are the centers to make children learn about the importance of hygiene, which is very important in anybody's life. Necessary sanitation facilities should be made available in the schools. In this regard, school authorities and teachers have significant role to play. The clean toilets and urinals, their role is very important and they should be cleaned regularly. So, let's discuss the role of school authorities, what role they play in adopting the hygiene in school. There should be separate toilet for girls in co-ed schools. Children must feel safe when they visit the facility without having risk for harassment, attack by animals like snakes in rural areas. Proper locking systems should be there, like bolts and handles. Supervision by attendant in case of pre-primary and girl child. Sanitation facility should not contaminate groundwater. Toilet blocks should be cleaned twice a day. The toilets and urinals should be physical challenge friendly and having low level handrail and ramps. Lighting and ventilation should be proper. Water supply should be adequate. Monitoring regular use of toilet cleaners. And let's discuss the importance of safe food. Children bring food from home for lunch break. They are also getting midday meals in the schools. In some schools, there are cafeterias too. Safe food is very important for children to keep them healthy and away from diseases. There should be a hand washing facility also in the schools for children. As children are taught to wash hands before and after meals, teachers should also encourage them to wash hands even after handling animals, throwing garbage, visiting sick persons, after playing, sneezing, coughing, using toilets and urinals. Some provisions have to be made in schools as proper and continuous supply of water, child-friendly wash basins at minimum height, proper arrangement of soaps and hand wash liquid. Pre-primary students must be accompanied by teachers or nanny when they visit to the washrooms. So, what should be the drainage facility in a school? Let's discuss. Proper drainage system is the need of every school to keep the environment healthy and clean. If drainage system is not well maintained, mosquitoes will breed freely in dirty and clogged water, and there will be common diseases like malaria, dengue, etc. It will increase absenteeism also. If the child falls sick, he will be absent regularly. The school authorities and teachers have a separate role to play to make the school environment healthy. Following steps should be taken by the school authorities. The first step could be covering of the drains so that there are no casualties. Regular cleaning of drains by local bodies to avoid blockage. Regular repair of the pipelines to avoid water clogging. Regular use of disinfectants, pesticides and insecticides to avoid the breeding of insects. And teachers should be attentive also about that no child should play near uncovered drain or avoid casualties. No child should throw any object like balls, stones, plastic bags and handkerchief into the drain to avoid blockage. No child should play with dirty clogged water. In rural areas where there are fewer facilities, teachers have to be more careful. We can overcome this with coordinated and combined effort of school authorities, local governing bodies, parents, teachers and students also. And there should be a proper system of refusal of disposal. Fast development and flow from rural to urban have contributed to unhealthy environment in the metros like air and water pollution. The waste disposal is also one of the major problems. This can be easily controlled when we start taking initiative at the school level. We can manage waste by applying 4 R's, that is refuse, reuse, reduce and recycle. And an activity can also be done in the class, like the teacher should place 3 separate dustbin in the class, namely A, B and C. The A dustbin is for leftover food, B is for only papers and C is for plastic, polythene, metals, etc. And she or he should ask the children to identify the waste and throw in the bin according to the material. She should say that put waste of A in compost pit to prepare manure by adding garden soil, dried leaves and twigs. Put waste of B in water, add plaster of Paris, tissue papers and prepare different paper mache items like fruits, vegetables, pencil stand, etc. And for waste C, we can tell them that plastic material and poly bags are very harmful for our environment. After burning, they release harmful carbon dioxide. It should not be burned, rather sold out for recycling. And the hand washing area should be cleaned regularly with cleansers. Wash basins should be according to school strength. In rural areas, water buckets, soap and mugs must be kept. Let's discuss the lighting system in schools. The visual environment is very important for learners' ability and mental attitude. Proper lighting improves in respiration, heart action and brain activity, whereas dim light reverse effects as sleep being facilitated. In rural areas, some schools are in open and children don't face light problems. And whereas in urban areas, classrooms should have adequate lighting arrangements, having 4 to 5 tubes in a room. Classroom should have warm color paints on walls to give more lighting effect. Teacher should be careful about lighting. Before starting the day, She should make sure that lights are on electrical wires and they should be checked regularly and replaces with new ones if damaged. Electrical repair should be done timely. Child having visual problems should be made seated where maximum light is available. So, what should be the ventilation system in schools? Let's discuss it. Wherever we sit, stand or sleep, proper ventilation is required. Windows are the cheap and efficient solution to fresh air and climate control in schools. Children in well-ventilated classroom perform better than their peers who get adequate fresh air. Urban areas experience these problems more than rural. In rural areas, the classrooms are in open or in tents, whereas in urban areas, schools are in buildings, so ventilation is a hazard. School should have proper ventilation in classrooms with proper windows so that the classrooms are neither too hot in summers or not too cold in winters. Let's discuss the comfortable sitting arrangements. To make the learning more effective, comfortable sitting arrangements should be done in the class. Teacher can put her best to be comfortable and approachable to every child. In elementary classes, there should be different sitting arrangements according to the activities to be done in the class, like group work, group discussion, writing work, performing art, etc. And teacher should be more careful about the sitting arrangement of the child with special need. If teacher is having children with special need or visual auditory problem, child, he or she has to arrange their seats accordingly. And sitting arrangement is like group work. In the case of group work, sitting arrangement should be in clumps or cluster. And for group discussion, teacher should have an eye contact with every child. And for writing work, every child should have clear view of the board. And in the case of performing art, children should be given enough space to perform. And with child with a special need, they should be seated near the door. And for troublemakers, they should be seated near teacher so that their activities are monitored regularly. And in case of evaluation, teacher should have maximum space to monitor the children. Teacher should make sure that he or she has enough seats to accommodate the class. So, what should be the conducive emotional and social environment? Environment begins with the room and extends to the behavior of the teacher as well as students. We don't mean only physical environment, but emotional and social environment also. The teacher should establish an atmosphere that respects all differences in individuals. Students have opportunity to feel capable, connected, and contributing members of the school. Students should be encouraged to become actively involved in their school and classroom activities. It becomes necessary for the teacher to take following steps to ensure the classroom is inviting and welcoming for the students. Number one, greeting programs. The teachers greeting every student by naming them at the classroom door make the child more comfortable. The next one is she or he can construct a newcomer club. Newcomers should be welcome and involved in school and classroom activities. And to create a classroom environment, a conducive environment that enhances emotional and social relationship, changing seats frequently is also very important. This allows students to work with different classmates and make new friends. This also promotes social interaction and emotional bonding among the peers. One-on-one contact. Teacher should interact individually with every child to make him feel free, comfortable, and more confident. And the seniors should provide reading and other assistance to the juniors. And there should be an anti-discrimination policy also. Like, teacher should develop anti-discrimination policies on factors like gender, family status, religion, age, etc. for giving healthy socio-emotional environment. It will ensure positive learning to students. Teacher can also ask for or narrate true stories of relatives, friends, their achievements and problems, etc. Teacher should not let any child feel inferior in the class. Now, let's discuss the health instructions. To inspire the child with the desire to be well and happy is possible only through health instructions. As we give normal instructions to the child, it is also very important to give the health instructions. And it is a duty of the teacher to make aware his or her students regarding the health. And health instructions should include the instructions regarding food, balanced diet, diseases, postures and healthy habits, etc. Now, what kind of food one should take and what is balanced diet? Let's discuss this first. Any edible substance which one eats and which provides material or materials useful for the body of a living being can be termed as food. Main sources of food are plants and animals. Green plants prepare their own food with the help of sunlight, air, water and minerals from the soil. They provide us cereals, pulses, vegetable, fruit, sugar, vegetable oil, spices, nuts and beverages. And animals provide us food in the form of milk, meat, egg, fish and honey. Food helps us to grow, keeps us healthy also. It supplies the energy for every action we undertake, from eating banana to running a race. It also protects us from diseases. Our food should have all the nutrients like carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins, etc. Nutrients provide energy to the body to work and play. We can classify nutrients as carbohydrates, fats, proteins, mineral salt, etc. Now, let's discuss the sources of these nutrients. The carbohydrates are the energy giving food and its sources are wheat, rice, potato, sugar, mango, banana, etc. Sources of fats are ghee, which we normally use in our cooking, butter, orange, nuts, etc. The sources of proteins are vegetables, pulses, cheese, egg, milk, fish, etc. The sources of minerals are, these are also, minerals are also called the protective food, and its sources are milk, cheese, green leafy vegetables, pulses, etc. And vitamins are also called the protective food. The sources of vitamins are fruits, vegetables, egg, milk, etc. And roughage is also equally important nutrient, as we have discussed earlier. Roughage is the fiber content of the plant. Its sources are salad, vegetables, the raw vegetables and fruits. It helps in digestive system. And the water, it is most important component for working of our body. And it is important that we consume all nutrients, but it is equally important that we consume them in adequate manner. This is what makes our diet a balanced diet. So, if we define balanced diet, it can be said that a balanced diet is one which contains all the nutrients in proper amount according to age and work we do. No single food item offers all the nutrients by our body. Only a combination of different food items in adequate quantity will form a balanced diet. And balanced diet implies a complete meal. The factors which affects our diet are age, sex, body size, and eating habits and social customs, climate factors, health status, and growth. Psychological factors are also there which affects our health. And we must understand that people at different age and conditions need different nutrients in different quantities. Like growing children need more proteins to build their body, and the infants need more of vitamins and proteins to build their bodies and to keep diseases away. The nursing mothers and pregnant women also need more of proteins to serve the need of the growing baby. And a hard-working laborer who does a lot of physical work needs more of carbohydrates and fats to get energy. So there are hundreds of items that we eat, but our diet must include foodstuffs from the following groups. The first group is milk group. It includes milk, cheese and other milk products. The next group is meat group. It includes meat, chicken, fish, lamb, etc. for non-vegetarians, and for vegetarians, soybeans, beans, peas, grams, nuts and seeds, etc. And the another group is fruit and vegetables group. All kinds of vegetables and fruits comes under this group. The next group is cereals and wheat group. It includes wheat, rice and other cereals. Now let's discuss the communicable disease. It is necessary to stay fit and free from diseases because it leaves the person very weak, and prolonged diseases result in death also. Diseases may be the result of infection, sometimes heredity and sometimes deficiency disease. In this lesson, you will study about disease which occurs due to infection in our body. What is the meaning of disease? Disease is a state of discomfort in which the normal functioning of body is disturbed. Some of the common diseases are malaria, typhoid, chickenpox, eye flu, etc. And the causes of its spread, the communicable diseases, the causes may be the air or touch, but there are other modes also. These diseases spread through air, water, food and contact. You know that germs are present everywhere around us and they can spread through four modes. The first one is food and water, next air, contact and insects also. And how it spreads through food and water? The uncovered food and water get contaminated with germs and unhygienic preparation, serving and storing, dirty hands and utensils and dirty surroundings also help in contaminating food and water and spreading disease. And the air, whenever a person suffering from disease like influenza, measles, etc., cough, speaks or sneeze, his germs enters a healthy person's body when he breathes in and likely to catch the disease. Contact. A communicable disease may also spread through direct contact, that is when we touch the person having disease, and indirect contact when we use anything already used by him like towel, cup, hanky, etc. Insects may also cause diseases. Like flies also carry germs from garbage on their bodies and infect the food on which they sit. This causes cholera, and mosquitoes cause malaria. Let's discuss the difference between communicable and non-communicable disease. Disease which spreads from person to person is known as communicable disease. These diseases are also known as infectious disease like mumps, measles, tuberculosis, AIDS, cold, cough, eye flu, etc. For example, a healthy person can catch cold anytime. If a disease does not spread from one person to another person, it is said to be non-communicable disease like blood pressure, diabetes, heart stroke. For example, if a mother is having blood pressure, the child is not going to have it by infection. So learners, today we have discussed a healthful school environment in which we covered good surroundings the children should have, the importance of hygiene for children. We have covered the communicable diseases, meaning of communicable diseases and non-communicable diseases. We have also discussed about a good diet, a balanced diet and the nutrients also. We have discussed the sources of the nutrients also. And we hope that this lecture will be beneficial for you. And thanks for listening. Thank you.